Conversation with a Geographer. I'm Mike DeVivo, professor of geography at Grand Rapids Community College. And today, we're privileged to have Daniel Arreola, professor emeritus of Arizona State University. Dan, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, Mike. Welcome, and great to be here. Great to be here.
Excellent. As I start all of these conversations, I'll ask you to reflect on your childhood, perhaps, and what might have sparked your interest in pursuing geography as a field of study that really has shaped your career.
Yes. Well, I've thought about this often. In fact, I've written about it because there's little doubt that this happened at a very tender age. And it was my maternal grandparents. I was raised by my mother's parents in Santa Monica, California. And these people were immigrants from Jalisco, Mexico in the early 20th century. So my grandfather was something of a peripatetic walker. He used to walk all over Santa Monica. And the stories are from all of my relatives and my mother, who's long since passed, but she used to tell me this. She says, "Grandfather used to take you for walks. And he would walk me around the neighborhood. And I used to go, you know, I was very adventuresome. This was 3, 4, 5 years old, that age time. And apparently, Leon Diaz was his name. He was also a storyteller. And so he used to love to tell stories as he walked me along through the neighborhood. And I was fascinated by all of this, obviously, because he was telling me about, oh, who lives in this house and where they came from. And you know, look at those plants over there. And aren't those interesting? And this house is this a different house from that house? So in other words, long before I encountered academic geography or even grade school geography, I was impregnated with this fascination with the world around me by my grandfather. So when I got to high school, grade school and high school, we had geography classes in Santa Monica Public School District, and I thought it was fun, but it wasn't until I was at university at UCLA that I discovered it as a profession. I started as a political science major, but I switched to geography when I took a physical geography class, and I was so amazed by what they were telling me.
Who was teaching the course?
Well, at UCLA at the time, you had a big lecture hall, and our lecturer was a recent PhD from UCLA. His name was Schwartz, as I recall. But I had a TA who was a guy who ended up going to Montana, I think Missoula. His name was Fogan, and he was fascinated. This was about the time that Surtsey, the volcano, mm-hmm. was coming
yes.
up off Iceland. And so he was talking about all these things, and I was just fascinated by this stuff. And the next chance I got, I changed my major from political science to geography, although I enjoyed political science, but geography was just fascinating. So physical geography led to human geography. And of course, I ended up majoring at UCLA in geography, which was a wonderful program at the time because they had so many faculty at that time from all over the world, people that had regional interests in Africa, regional interests in the USSR and Russia, regional interests in Southeast Asia. And so I was taking classes from all these people and just absolutely loving it. When I decided that I was going to go on for a master's degree, I was taken under the wing of Kit Salter, who was then a yeah. faculty member at mm-hmm. UCLA. I took his advice. If you want to go on for a master's degree, he said he recommended a program where he had taught when he was at Berkeley as a PhD student, and that's Cal State Hayward, which mm-hmm. is now Cal State East Bay. A lot of the geographers there were former Berkeley geographers. Mm-hmm. He knew them all, and he highly recommended them. So I went up and interviewed with Bill Thomas. This is Bill Thomas mm-hmm. of Spencer Thomas textbook fame. And Spencer had been a geographer at UCLA all of my undergraduate career, but I'd never had classes from him. I was a Henry Brueman protege. Henry Brueman was another early Sauer student, and I was taking classes.
Yeah, 1940s. He did the yes. work on drinks in New Spain.
That's right. That's right. He was very instrumental in that stuff. Anyway, my goal was to go to the Bay Area, just to live in the Bay Area. I'd grown up in Southern California. I wanted to get out of SoCal. So Salter said, yeah, go up to Hayward. He says they have a really good program. You can get a master's degree, and then you can teach in the community college system. I said, oh, that's perfect. That's exactly what I wanted to do. This was 1972. So I got up to Hayward. I got into the program. There were a number of people up there. In fact, Larry Dilsaver, a historical geographer, was part of that cohort.
Really? Larry was at
Larry
Hayward.
Was in the program with me there. And there were a bunch of other ones, some very famous ones, in fact. Susan Cutter, She was an undergraduate at Hayward. Court Wilmot later went to Delaware, and then Colorado. So there were a number of up and coming geographers there, because we didn't know that at the time. But I loved the program. It was heavily field oriented. A lot of very good geographers. And I saddled up to Herb Eater, and Herb Eater ended up becoming my advisor. I did a master's thesis on a little Chinese community in the Sacramento Delta called Lac. I was interested in Chinese studies because Salter had prompted that as an undergraduate at UCLA.
That's a really intriguing area with regard to that small Chinese community.
It's fascinating. I mean, there are Chinese all over the Delta area. Mm-hmm. I really enjoyed that. Anyway, the goal was to get this thesis and then have a master's degree and be able to teach. And I was going to try and teach in the Bay Area. But of course, 1972, 73 in California was a recession.
Right.
And the first thing I learned very quickly within a year in the program is that there were not going to be any full-time hires in the community college system in the Bay Area or in California for that matter. It was really cramping down. They were closing things off. They were hiring people part-time, but nobody was going to be hired tenure leading or in a permanent program. And once that became clear, I continued with the program because I liked it so much, did my master's thesis. And then I asked my advisors, I said, well, what should I do from here on? I obviously can't be employed full time in the community college system. And Bill Thomas, I remember, he says, well, you can go on for a PhD, Dan. I said, well, what's that? He said, well, if you want to do Asian studies, you need to go back east. Thomas, remember, had gone back east and to Yale. And taken Asian studies there. So he recommended I go back east to an Asian studies program, not a geography program. And I looked at Thomas, I said, back east? I said, that's too far away, Bill. I said, you know, I'm a Southern California boy. I'm a West Coast person. I don't want to go back east. So I said, what's the alternative? He says, well, you can go back and study with Salter because Salter's a China specialist. So I did that. I went back to UCLA, studied with Salter. But after about a year, I'd taken Mandarin Chinese, actually, when I was in the Bay Area. I went to an intensive language class at Berkeley one summer. Mandarin was great. You learned how to write, but the spoken language of the people that I was looking at for my master's thesis were not Mandarin speakers. They were Chungshanese. They were people from the southern part of what is now Guangdong. And they didn't speak Mandarin, but it didn't matter. I learned enough about the writing that it was enriching. So when I continued my second year of Mandarin at UCLA under Salter as a beginning PhD student, thinking that I would be able to go to China to do field work, after about a year of that, it was plain that I wasn't going to get money to go to China. I wasn't going to be able to get into China. And I said, I'm going to change directions. So I decided to become a Latin Americanist. And I went back to my own ancestry that way. It made sense. And I developed a study program in Mexico. Salter still stayed on as my advisor, but Henry Brumman joined the group, and then a couple of Latin Americanists in the history program that helped me, and Gary Dunbar, also who was a historical geographer at the time, was instrumental in, mm-hmm. in teaching me about American and Canadian and English and really European
history. Yeah, and Dunbar, who had done his PhD under Niffen at LSU.
That's right. Dunbar was a fantastic mm-hmm. mentor for me. I remember he was a tutor for myself and another PhD student. There were only a few historical geography students there at the time. This was in the mid 70s to early 80s or to about 1980. Robert Block was the other one. Block mm-hmm. ended up going to Chicago, as I recall, but we both finished our PhDs and Dunbar was on our committee. So I think Dunbar was his major advisor. So I finished, it took me a while because I'd not wasted a year, but I'd used up a year, a little over a year, thinking I was still going to do the Chinese program. And so I had to switch gears, get reassociated with Latin American studies, took classes, seminars in geography and outside of geography, developed a dissertation program looking at the historical geography of travel and travelers between Veracruz, Mexico, and Mexico City. I got fascinated with that area. Spent a couple of different field periods there, extended field periods, getting to know the terrain and develop a thesis that actually looked at how this particular part of Mexico, which is really an interesting environmental area because it goes from sea level to about 9,000 feet up at the passes before it goes into the Valley of Mexico. And it was an environment that in the 19th century, when Mexico became independent, opened itself up to travelers, because under Spain it had closed itself off. It opened itself up to travelers, and everybody and his brother in the second half of the 19th century wanted to go to Mexico. And not only did they go to Mexico, but then they wrote about their travels. So there were something like, I uncovered about 450 travel accounts that had been written between the early to mid 19th century until when the railroad was starting to be constructed in eastern Mexico in the 1870s. And I stopped with the railroad because that changed the whole way in which people were transiting across this landscape. When they were going by horseback, walking, and by what was called litter, where they would have two mules with a kind of canopy in between, and the guys would sit inside this canopy and the mules would carry them up the hill slope. When they were going that slow, they were observing everything. And they were looking at things, and then they wrote about this with great detail. Once the railroad came in and people were going in the train, they were just going point A to point B, and they didn't much care about what they saw in between. They couldn't see that much in between. And so I cut it off at the time that they were the railroad came in. And I wrote about then how this coincided with the period of the popularity of not just world travel, but also the greater knowledge about writing and reading, because popular writing actually became very popular in the second half of the 19th century. And so it all fed into how people were getting exposed to kind of a common geography of places they knew nothing about, long before the National Geographic was making the world known to people in a popular vein. And I got very intrigued with that kind of geography from my dissertation.
That's fascinating. And I guess I would have to think that maybe Bruman's influence played a role as well in terms of directing you toward that part of Mexico.
He did. In fact, what Bruman wanted me to do, he kept trying to nudge me, although he never dictated. He was a very fair advisor. He never laid it out and said, you have to do this, Dan. He'd done all this work with the Huichol. And the drink areas of, colonial right. Spain, right? And he'd worked on vanilla. He'd done all of these things really innovative. And it turns out in retrospect to having been pioneering studies in things that we knew very little about. But he kept telling me, he says, Dan, go back to where the Huichol are. He says, there's some fascinating areas there of Mexico. He says, you can get lost in there. And he says, you can find dissertation topics left and right there. He says, there's just so many things that you'll stumble across that will intrigue you. But I didn't. I got captivated by eastern Mexico and by Veracruz. And so that ended up being the target.
Not much is known about Henry Bruman. Would you care to share some comments about him? He was a nice guy.
He was German. He was a German citizen, but he came to America early on and was raised in the United States, became educated at Berkeley. His background, as I remember, if I can remember correctly, was actually in chemistry. In other words, as an undergraduate, he'd studied the sciences, the hard sciences. But then this was at UCLA. He was in Southern California at this time, and apparently the geographers that he was studying with there in the late 30s and up to the late 30s were advising him that if he wanted to study geography at the PhD level, he had to go to Berkeley and study with Sauer.
Well, UCLA didn't have a graduate program.
PhD program, that's right.
The 50s, I guess.
That's right, quite late.
Yeah.
So he went to Berkeley and ended up studying with Sauer. And, I know a little bit about Sauer and early Sauer students because having lived in the Bay Area and having interacted with Sauer and Parsons and others when they were still alive, when I was a master's student, there were a number of them. I think Parsons had once told me, he says, he thought that Sauer had said that he thought Henry Bruman was the brightest geographer he's ever trained. And he says he didn't have to do much training with Henry, he says, because Henry knew what he wanted to do. And then Bruman became an absolute ambassador for Alexander von Humboldt. Mm-hmm. And he ended up studying things about Humboldt. He went back to Germany, studied his manuscripts, never published that much about Humboldt, but became very instrumental in various research programs in Germany and in the United States that had to do with Humboldt's geography. And he was always willing to talk at length about Humboldt. He knew Humboldt backwards and forwards. It was really quite impressive. And then, of course, when Henry passed, he had made a fair amount of money in real estate in Southern California.
Right.
He endowed then the Humboldt chair at UCLA, that Dennis Cosgrove was the first geographer to sit in that chair. I can't remember who's been in it since then. There've been a couple, as I recall. But I remember when Dennis was in it. I'd met Dennis Cosgrove when I was at Texas A&M, one of my early jobs outside of California, and struck up a good relationship with him and stayed in touch with him. And when he got the broom and chair, I thought it was fabulous that he could go to UCLA and blazed paths there for things that he'd already become quite famous even mm-hmm. before he had the broom and chair. But he was there for a number of years before he passed, way before his time. So Brumman was instrumental in creating Latin American studies programs through UCLA and both through Latin American students that he mentored at UCLA. He was a tremendous geographer, little appreciated and little known because he didn't publish that much. You see, he published very early on, and then he spent most of the rest of his life doing a variety of things. He'd actually worked in South America before he came back to UCLA. He'd studied the migrations of Germans to South America. This became a big thing after the war. And so he was involved with some of that stuff. But Henry knew the world really well. He was a great mentor to me. I really admired him. I'll never forget the classes that I had with him when I was his TA, or when I had undergraduate and graduate classes with him. Students would always ask, UCLA was on the quarter system every 10 weeks. And so we had a midterm exam and a final exam, and that was it. And students would always ask Brumman, they'd say, well, what do we have to know for the exam? You know, students typically, give us an idea of what it is that we have to know. And Brumman would always look at them and have a big Cheshire cat smile on his face. He says, well, you know, the more you know, the more you know. And then the student would sit there and go, oh, okay, that's the attitude, right? Learn as much as you can and you'll do okay. That was his mantra.
Yeah. Great. And what about Salter?
Kit was my undergraduate mentor because Kit was, he got to UCLA from Berkeley, his first big job, and he was a very popular professor.
Mm-hmm. Very popular with lectures. And
He was an outstanding lecturer. He was a very outgoing person. He embraced people. He was always upbeat. And so students loved him. They fell in love with him. And I fell under that spell as an undergraduate. And he's the one who advised me off to do my master's, as I said a minute ago. And then when I came back, he became my PhD advisor. And I still stay in touch with him.
Mm-hmm.
He left UCLA. He became the father of the geographic education
right.
program.
Right, the California Geographic Alliance, National Geographic.
That's right. He did all of that. He was literally the father of that program, and he was he should forever be known because of that. He left UCLA and went to University
Missouri.
Of Missouri, mm-hmm. and he was there for a number of years, and then he retired from there and he stayed in Missouri. He and his wife Chloe. And only in the last 3 years has he relocated. He's now in the foothills of the Sierra Nevada dealing with 5 feet of snow right now. I talked with him on FaceTime just recently.
In the foothills of the Sierra.
They live in Nevada City. They live in Nevada
City. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
There's a lot of snow there now.
Yes, there is. There is. But Salter was a wonderful advisor. He was, again, even I was so happy that he allowed me to stay with him when I switched gears away from China. He says, well, as long as what you're studying is cultural geography, I guess I'm a legitimate advisor, which he was. And he had a great stable of students when I was a PhD student there. We were all field oriented. We used to take field trips with Salter down into Baja, Mexico, and to other places in Southern California, out to the desert areas and the mountain areas. He had about nine of
Did you stay in the northern Baja or did you go south?
No, we'd stay in northern Baja. We never really went too far south, but we would have these kind of collective. Salter was going through changes in his life too, as he was mentoring all nine of us or more. And so we would uh, we would help one another. In other words, he would want us to get together and he would talk to us about various things when we got out in the field, but we would then act as sounding boards to some of the issues that he was having as he was going through transformations in his own life, both personal and professional. Mm-hmm. And it was a wonderful kind of exchange. And if you think about it, that was kind of an unusual thing, because too many of the PhD people that I know, they had a very formal relationship with their mentor. And the mentor never let them in too close. You know, it was always, well, you know, I'm your mentor and I do these kinds of things for you, but, you know, my personal life is my personal life, which is completely understandable. But Salter was a very open person as a human being, and he wanted other people to have, he wanted empathy from them, and he wanted to be sympathetic to the things that were part of their lives. So I think it was one of the things I learned from him is the humanity of being an academic, not just being an academic, but, you know, that it is something that involves human lives. It's not just, you know, the kind of work that you do in that kind of environment. So I've always admired Kit, and I stay in touch with him to this day.
Do you think he learned some of those attributes from his mentor?
He could have, you know, he worked with Jim Parsons.
Right. Very kind man.
Yes. Parsons was a wonderful person. He was a wonderful person. But Sauer was also on Kit's committee. I think it was maybe one of the last committees that he was on. It could have been, you know, Salter had, one of the other reasons I think I became close to Kit is that he had difficulties with his father. And he wasn't afraid to talk about those kinds of relationships early in his life. And I had those issues with my father when he was alive. So Kit was sympathetic to kind of distancing between a son and a father figure. And so Parsons definitely was a father figure for Kit. I mean, he admitted that outright. And they stayed close till the day that Parsons died. Kit would call him every day on Father's Day. And it was like, you know, that was that kind of a relationship. So, yeah, it's entirely possible that that some of that mentoring knowledge came from the relationships he had with Jim Parsons, who was a fabulous geographer.
A great geographer and a great human being, really, in so many ways. Do you recall any of the students that you went to Mexico with? Are they still in geography?
Well, the closest one that I the one that I came closest to during my PhD years at UCLA was Jim Curtis. Jim Curtis ended up doing his PhD on Alviso, a little town in the southern San Francisco Bay Area, really part of Metro San Jose, if I'm not mistaken. But he studied the little Mexican immigrant community there as his dissertation. So he was always interested in Mexico. And because he grew up in San Diego, he'd always had these relationships with Baja and with Mexico. So when Jim and I finished, he finished before I did, went off to Miami before he came back to Oklahoma and then back to Southern California. We always stayed in touch. We were very close. And it was Jim's association with me that led us to work together on the U.S.-Mexico border. I had been invited to participate in that program when I was a PhD student at, or not a PhD, I was a PhD at University of Arizona, a part-time job, and then I went to Texas A&M for a full-time job. And the invitation to participate in that was part of a big program at UCLA with a number of different kinds of scholars that were trying to write a whole series of volumes about the U.S.-Mexico border. And so they invited me to participate in this. And I said, yeah, this would be great, because there hadn't been very many geographers that had actually done field work in these border towns.
That's right. And that was a time when really the borderland studies were really emerging.
That's right.
They had not been really looked at too seriously before.
That's correct.
And
I asked Jim, I said, they've invited me to do this thing, and I've proposed that I write about all these Mexican border towns. And I said, but I have to go to them. And I said, don't you want to come along with me and sort of keep me company? And so Jim went along with me. And before we hadn't gone through about three or four of the border towns, we started in San Diego and in Baja, and then went, made our way east. And we hadn't gone through about two or three towns. And one night after we'd been, you know, walking around in these towns and talking with people and drawing maps and taking pictures, we sat down, we were over a couple of beers, we had a couple of napkins out, and Jim started outlining things. He says, you know, this was supposed to be an article for a journal. And Jim says, Dan, there's much more here than a journal article. And pretty soon we both agreed that there was a book here. And that led to about 3 years of collaboration and continually going back to these border towns. And finally, the Mexican Border Cities book, which was published by the University of Arizona Press in 1993. And Jim Curtis and I were the authors of that book. And it actually was, in some ways, I think, a quite important book because a lot of geographers were interested in the border, but not enough geographers had written about it to actually set up sort of an agenda of things that might be looked at. And we did a kind of overview of all 18 towns, but at the same time, we'd spent enough time in each town that we could map these places, we could understand their basic framework of historical geography, cultural geography, urban geography. And that's what the book was. And I think it was well received.
I think it was well received. Hey, would you comment just briefly on ethnicity? Like in Mexicali, for example, kind of an aberration.
Gosh. Fabulous place. Of course, I just finished the fourth volume of four books that I did on the U.S.-Mexico border towns much more intensely than Jim and I were ever able to do because I had the time to go back to them and look at them much more carefully. Mm-hmm. I was trying to tell the story of these places with postcards. A little particular form of ephemera that I became fascinated with. Anyway, Mexicali is an amazing place. And Jim knows this well because Jim wrote one of the pioneering articles about the Chinese community in Mexicali called La Chinesca.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I was just there 2 years ago, 3 years ago now, before I finished the Baja Border Town book. And at that time, I hadn't been to Mexicali in probably 5 or 8 years at least. And I was impressed to see that the government, the local government with national government funds is actually gentrifying the Chinatown called La Chinesca in Mexicali. And they're improving it remarkably. They're doing beautiful things to restore some of the architecture, to try and bring some of the art back that was the Chinese art there. But yeah, Mexicali is highly unusual as a community, not just on the border, but for all of Mexico.
Absolutely.
It has an amazing concentration of Chinese mm-hmm. ancestry people. Yeah.
And the Chinese food is good.
It's very good. It's very good. Well, it's this interesting mix. It's this hybridity of Chinese mm-hmm. and Mexican. You know, these people intermarried. They became a different group. But the food melding, the food ways melding there was just spectacular. It's really good.
It is. Hey, talk just a bit about your postcards. I think this is fascinating because I think we're in an era where postcards aren't really used that much anymore. Not like they were as recently as 6 or 7 years ago.
And I'm
thinking there may be a generation in the future that is just going to stick with the cell phones, you know, and take a photo and text it on Instagram or something like that. I don't know.
Well, so postcards, of course, people that know postcards know the history of them. They're a late 19th century phenomena out of Europe. And they evolved out of the greeting card, or actually, you know, people used to introduce themselves with a letter. They'd have a card that had their name on it, and they used to introduce themselves that way. But during the Austro-Prussian War in the 1870s, soldiers used to write back to people on their greeting, on their cards, and they would put them in the mail. And apparently, those were the first sort of post, what we would call postcards. And then by the late 19th, early 20th century in Europe, they became a formal way of communicating through the mails, and as equally in the United States. And I got interested in postcards because, as I've told many people, I have the collection gene. I was a collector when I was a kid. I collected baseball cards, I collected stamps, I collected coins, I collected maps. You know, you had this thing for collecting. And so when I started, I gave up baseball card collecting a long time ago, map collecting as well, coins and stamps, those went out the window a long time ago, even though I still have them. When I was at ASU, I'd always bought postcards, historic postcards, now and then in an antique store or something like that. When I was in ASU, I found out about a club, a postcard club in the Phoenix area. And I went to one of their meetings, and I was so fascinated by what they were doing and how they were collecting, and they educated me to what postcard collecting was all about, that I just jumped in whole hog. And next thing you know, I'm starting to collect these cards, because it coincided with what Jim and I had been just finishing up with the Border Town stuff. We'd already sort of finished the project. We'd used some cards in it, but not very good cards. But I got so fascinated with it, and I started collecting these cards, and I became known all across the country. Like, I went to shows, and I would buy things online. I became known as the guy that bought Mexican border towns. And pretty soon, collectors all over the country knew about me. Well, I did this for, you know, several decades, and I built up a collection, an archive of about 10,000 individual postcard images, all historic images of the Mexican border towns. And I used those cards. I'd use them in my lectures when I would teach at ASU on the border, of course, and in different presentations, public presentations. But the cards were always going to be this database that I could go to try and see how these towns had actually changed through time. Because I had cards from the early 1900s, 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. So you could actually see change through time by assembling a pretty deep archive of these cards. My photographer colleague friend, Mark Klett, who is a famous photographer and done wonderful work himself on the history of the West with photography, he called it image. If you collect enough imagery about a place, you have a way to connect that imagery through time. He was the one that introduced me to that idea. And I said, Mark, I said, this is what postcards do. They were never intended to be that way. They were commercial products. But the photographers that made these postcards, they'd go back to a town one a generation later, a different photographer. They'd take the same landmarks, the same street scenes, because those were the things that the postcards were going to facilitate, right? So if you have this over many generations, what you have what I call serial imagery. You have imagery through time of the same place over and over and over again. Well, that became a hook for me. I said, this is a way to see these places, these Mexican border towns. Because the border towns, unlike my doctoral work that had depended on guidebooks, the border towns weren't being written about. They were too new, and there weren't enough people that went to them to write guidebooks about them. So what I learned is that the postcards were a kind of guidebook. People would collect these things. They would go home, they'd put them in albums, they'd share them with their friends, and they became a way that they would tell the stories of their visits to the border towns, especially if they wrote on the back of them, because they would have things to say about the places they visited, but they didn't always write on them. So that became an obsession. As I said, over a couple of decades, I collected about 10,000 of these cards, and I wrote four different volumes about the Mexican border towns, using these cards to try and tell these stories and excavate the past of the towns, the landscapes of the towns, using the postcard imagery. It's fabulous fun.
It's a great story that you've really been able to tell about the changing cultural landscapes.
Yes. Well, it is. I'm an ambassador for this because I try and tell people that, you know, I did this because I was invested in these border communities from an earlier research agenda. I said, but anybody can do this. If you get a deep enough archive, you can actually do this for any town or any place in the world, because postcards, of course, were international. From the late 19th to the mid 20th century, as you were saying, they were the Instagram and the tweet of their day, that people would send these things by the billions across the country and around the world. And so they're all over the place. They're a very accessible form. There's a lot of collecting of it. But one of the things that's happening now is that archives and museums and historical societies are realizing that people's deep collections can actually be a very valuable resource. So now that I'm done with my collecting of the border towns, I'm actually donating my collection of 10,000 images to a photographic collection at Texas State San Marcos. There's a photographic archive there called the Whitliff Collection. And the Whitliff Collection is probably one of the best Latin American photographic archives in all of the United States and maybe the world. They've been collecting Latin American photographers for a long time. And they've known about my work for years. So I met with them years ago before I finished the border project. And I said, well, I'll be happy to give you these things, but I can't give them to you until I'm done with them. Well, I finished the fourth volume of the book just last year, actually in 2021. And so I'm now in the process of organizing the cards, getting them appraised so that I can give them to the Whitliff. And they're already beginning to get installments of the donations that I'm giving them. So I'm happy to do that, because what they want to do is that they want to make them available to other researchers, you see. They're willing to invest money to digitize them all, put them on a website, and make them accessible to other researchers who want to know about what you can learn from these images as a collection. And that's encouraging when you have an organization that doesn't just want to put them away in a basement somewhere, but they want to actually make them accessible to other people. Then you know you've done something that has a utility to somebody else.
Well, and off the top of my head, I would think that our Latin Americanist colleagues at San Marcos would have graduate students that very well might be interested in pursuing this track for their own research.
Absolutely.
They're exemplary geographers, and I think highly of them. And what a great opportunity to direct students to.
Yes, it's, absolutely.
And so close to the border, too, especially with the work that they're doing now with regard to the border. It's fascinating. Well, Dan, we have just about a minute to go, and I'm going to have to ask you, really, about any insight you might have gained that you could probably reflect upon to provide words of wisdom or advice for aspiring geographers or even colleagues in our discipline.
Well, I think the thing, you know, we all are into geography for what it illuminates for each of us. So everybody has to find their own anchor in this. And I don't think that's a problem. People find their passions and you want to cultivate your passions. As long as you have a passion and you have a curiosity, I think it's great. In my own particular path, I've tried to, I'm happy that the AAG awarded me the Jackson Prize for one of my books.
Sure. Congratulations, by the way. I'll see you on Sunday.
and then this wonderful award for the last volume of the postcard books. Because in each one of those, my mission has always been, yes, I want to write for a scholarly audience, but I also want to write for a public. As a geographer, I feel strongly that we have a mission to reach out to the public to let them know what geography is so that they can discover things on their own through that. We don't just want to talk amongst our colleagues. I know that's an important thing. We all want to advance science within our fields and our subfields. But there's a necessity to reach outside. So one of the things I would encourage other geographers to do is to not give up that hope, because geography needs that kind of publicity beyond the National Geographic and all the expansion. Professional geography has done really tremendous amount of exposure compared to what it was when I first started. But it always needs that ambassador to reach out and to tell people, this is how geography can actually illuminate an understanding of the world around you.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. We are tasked with really informing the public about what geography is all about and what we can do. Why is it important for us to examine the why of where?
Yes. Yes. As you say, as you're famous for, Mike, geography lives.
Amen.
I love that expression.
All right.
A great one.
Thank you, Dan, so much.
Thank you, Mike. I'm honored to have participated. Thank you so much for inviting me.
It's been great to have this conversation. And this concludes this episode of Conversation with a Geographer.